In this video lecture, we're going to take a look at how to properly set up loop continuation conditions for while loops. Okay, let's get started. Recall that in prior examples, a sentinel value was some specific value that we checked against in our program logic. It could be numeric, for example, -1, a specific character, for example, capital Q, or in general, any other type. It's just some specific, recognizable value that we test against to determine whether or not to continue looping. So for sentinel-controlled while loops, the loop termination condition would be when some input equals the sentinel value. This would tell us that we want to stop looping, but we said that a while loop requires a loop continuation condition instead, or the input not being equal to the sentinel value. As shown here at the bottom, these loop continuation and termination conditions are the negatives of each other, as indicated by these logical not operators. So a while loop requires a loop continuation condition, which expresses the conditions under which looping continues as long as the condition remains true. But in designing our code, it's often simpler and more natural to express our looping in terms of the specific case under which the looping will terminate, or the false case. So here's a systematic way of properly setting up the needed while loop continuation condition. First, come up with a logical expression for the loop termination condition. Then, turn that termination condition into the needed continuation condition by simply negating that expression, as shown here. Finally, clean things up a bit by simplifying the expression using De Morgan's laws as possible. Let's go through the various parts of the pseudocode. As a refresher, we saw this back in the conditions lecture material, but here again is a table showing the negatives of all six possible simple conditional expressions. Remember that in this context, both A and B are most typically some simple numerical values or variables, or some expression which evaluates to some single numerical value, although chars can be involved with this as well. Also, remember that every one of these expressions in the left and right columns ultimately evaluates to one single Boolean value, either true or false. In general then, the negative, or logical not, of any conditional expression simply represents the everything else. For example, if A is equal to B, then the not of that, or the everything else, is A not equal to B. If A is less than B, then the not of that, or the everything else, is A greater than or equal to B. As a similar refresher, back in the conditions lecture material, we also presented the two De Morgan's laws, and we said we'd come back to them later on. Well, now it's later on. Incidentally, De Morgan's laws have absolutely nothing to do with that brand of rum with a pirate on it. De Morgan's laws are simply two logical equivalences in Boolean logic, which assert that these two expressions are logically equivalent. Here again, A and B themselves represent simpler conditional expressions which resolve to one single Boolean value, true or false. Earlier we said that you just have to take these on faith for now, but now let's see the proof. So here's a tabulated proof of De Morgan's laws, which are shown again on the bottom. Let's say that we have two conditional expressions, A and B, here on the left, whose values can each be either true or false, giving us these four possible logic combinations. Going left to right, we're simply tabulating the incremental logical progression of De Morgan's laws. These next two columns are the logical nots of A and B, then A and B. Then these two next columns in red represent the left and right sides of the first law, the not of this column and the or of these two columns. As you can see, both columns are identical, and therefore, we've shown the correctness of this first law. This next column is simply the logical OR of these first two columns. Then, these two next columns in red represent the left and right sides of the second law, the NOT of this column to the left, and the AND of these third and fourth columns. Again, as you can see, both columns are identical, and thus we've shown the correctness of this second law. Take a few moments if you'd like to digest this progression in a more leisurely and thorough way, but in the end you will hopefully come away convinced of the validity of these two De Morgan's laws. Next, let's start looking at how we'd put these laws to some actual use in a program setting. Consider the case where we'd like to write an application that handles some user keyboard input in a case-insensitive fashion. In other words, we want either a capital S, or lowercase s to terminate our program's execution. So therefore, we have these two Sentinel values. If we wanted to use these as part of our while loop's continuation condition, if we didn't think about it too much, we might come up with something like this as a first step. However, this wouldn't be correct. For example, if the user entered a capital S, this first condition would be false, but this second condition would still be true. Likewise, if the user entered a lowercase s, this second condition would now be false, but this first condition would still be true. So either way, this entire loop continuation condition would be true no matter what S keystroke the user entered. Of course, if the user entered any other character, this entire expression would also be true, as we would want, but that really does us no good because now we have no way of stopping this while loop from executing. We have what's known as an endless loop, because one of these expressions will always be true. So, this would not be the right way to set up this loop condition. Okay then, how do we set this up properly? Here's a simple algorithm for the correct way of setting up the needed loop condition. First, we start by defining the specific case of the loop termination condition instead. Our looping should end if the user inputs a capital S or a lowercase s, as expressed here. Note that this is a specific example of this general form shown in blue. Can you see where we're going with this? Next, turn the more easily expressed loop termination condition into the required loop continuation condition by simply negating the entire expression. So in our example, we simply apply the NOT operator to the entire prior expression, as shown here. Again, note that this specific example is of this general form shown in blue. Is this looking a little more familiar yet? Next, we can transform the expression by applying De Morgan's laws. Looking here on the right, we go from this form to this form by turning the interior OR operator into an AND operator and then distributing the NOT operator over both terms. Applying that to our example, we turn this interior OR into this AND and then negate each of these individual terms. Finally, we can simplify this a bit more through the use of negation. Recall the table of NOT equivalences we just saw. The NOT of some option being equal to some specific character is simply that option being not equal to that specific character. And this gives us a simplified and correct loop continuation condition. Now, if we stare at this and think about it for a moment, we'll realize that, yeah, of course, this is the right answer, and we probably could have come up with this on our own with a little trial and error. But this procedure provides us with a systematic set of steps to do that for more complicated logic. For an example of all this put to use, please finish up by viewing the short code walkthrough video for looping while switch menu.java, which you'll find in the usual place. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. This example will demonstrate setting up a code framework for handling case-insensitive keyboard input using a switch statement, which is something you'll need to understand well for current and upcoming programs. Okay, that's it though for this discussion of setting up proper while loop continuation conditions.